wonderful sight to see, to look at all of you here this morning. I'm Arvid Lopez. I'm contrary to what the program has with just my first name, I have not reached the status of Beyonce. I'm still using my last name as well. So I'm Arvid Lopez, and I'm the chair. I have the pleasure of being the chair of the board of an MPM band. And it is my pleasure to welcome you here to Austin. Now, for me, it's actually coming home in many ways. I grew up in South Texas, not too far south from here, near Corpus Christi. But it feels like coming home because I get to see all of you, which is really wonderful, particularly these challenging times that we're going through. But it's good to get together with people who are artists, who are colleagues, who are peers, who are partners, who care about this country and the people who live in it, and our relationship to the world. So thank you for what you do in your communities, and thank you for being here. Before we begin our annual meeting of MPM Band, I want to acknowledge the land we're on, the land of the Champoa, the Comanches, and Lipan Apaches. We enter this space with respect and gratitude for the First Peoples. The work of MPM Band is really dependent on a group of people like yourselves who care about this organization, who care about the artists and the communities we live in. The board of directors of MPM Band are here, and I want to acknowledge them and ask them if they will just go across the room, if they'll just wave to us or something. The teacher Bajugo, Javon Collins, Shannon Dow, Olga Garay English, Stephanie McKee, Joan Asado, Abe Ryback, Michelle Steinwald, Harold Stewart, Samuel Valdez, Shay Wafer, John White, Will Wilkins, and Rosie Gordon Walls, who is not able to join us, but is here in spirit and in heart. There's one individual, again, I do want to acknowledge again, and that's Abel Ryback, who's the media past chair of the board of directors.
I will.
Now it's my pleasure to introduce our president and CEO, Cowden Strokosch. Maybe didn't tell me to do that. MPM Band in July after serving as executive director of the Alliance of Artist Communities, an international association of artist residency programs. While at the Alliance, she organized international residencies for emerging Arab artists, conducted national-level research on the sustainability of artist residency programs and centers, and implemented several funding programs with national funders. Prior to joining the Alliance, however, she managed several nonprofit musical ensembles in Chicago. She is a frequent public speaker and has served on many panels of the National Endowment for the Arts, the Joyce Foundation, the Education Foundation of America, the Rasmussen Foundation, and the Rhode Island State Council on the Arts. She currently serves on the board of directors of Grantmakers in the Arts and the Performing Arts Alliance. It's now my pleasure to introduce to you our very thoughtful, insightful, strong, fearless, visionary partner and leader, and new president and CEO, Cowden Strokosch.
Well,
First off, I just want to say thank you in particular to our local hosts, Brad Carlin and Bob Berry from Fusebox. I know this has been a long planning process, and we're so grateful for all that you've done, and particularly for being our guides, our eyes and ears here in Austin, connecting us to so many local artists, and so many of the issues that matter, particularly to this place. Thank you for that. I also want to acknowledge our funders, many of you who are in this room with us, and I know in particular it is just really a joy and a pleasure to have you folks among us, to have us all enter this space together as peers. And so I want to say a special thank you to the Andrew Mellon Foundation, the Doris Duke Charitable Foundation, the Ford Foundation, Japan Foundation Center for Global Partnership, Japan-U.S. Friendship Commission, sorry it's a long list, not sorry, it's awesome it's a long list, Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs, the Joan Mitchell Foundation, the Lambent Foundation, the Louisiana Division of the Arts, National Endowment for the Arts, the Quixote Foundation, CERDNA, WESTAF, City of Austin Economic Development Department, Cultural Affairs Division, longest title ever, the Austin Convention and Visitors Bureau, and the Texas Commission on the Arts. Thank you all so much. And now, for all the people who make my job way easier and more glamorous and attractive and sparkly and awesome, who have poured themselves into this convening, y'all want to come on up here? Thank you so much to the staff, Benji and Dan. Making this transition with me as a true colleague. sharing all the moments over the last 6 months, some of them awkward, some of them graceful, all of them really in a spirit of respect and openness, and I'm so grateful, MK, for this transition and for you being with us here this week. So, as we begin these few days here together, we reaffirm our commitment to the freedom of expression, to anti-censorship, to a discourse that is centered on curiosity and challenging ourselves and each other, recognizing the sometimes clumsy and imperfect process of learning and growing together. We also declare ourselves an anti-oppression organization, committed to examining and dismantling systems of oppression based on race, ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, ability, age, religion, or creed. NPNVAN is by no means a perfect model for this work, and we invite you into this process with us as we grow and learn ourselves. At this annual meeting, we hope that you will explore how this commitment to anti-oppression may be applied to your own work, and we hope you'll engage with each other bravely and respectfully. And we hope if you encounter oppressive messages or actions during the annual meeting, that you are encouraged to shine a light on those moments so that we may grow together. We also invite you to share these moments with NPNVAN so that we may learn how to respond better as an organization. And for this purpose, we have established at this annual meeting our very own Justice League. I think you guys have, not capes, right? You said tiara, maybe better than capes. This is a group of individuals who were nominated by staff and board members, particularly for the job of ensuring that NPNVAN is informed and responsive to any incidents that may arise at the annual meeting. I just want to acknowledge Mina, Abe, Stephanie, Clements, and Steve Bailey as our Justice League members. Abe is definitely working on the superhero outfits, I think, as we speak. We invite you to seek them out if there's anything that you want to share with us during this annual meeting, and of course also seek out any board members or staff members so that we may respond and grow together in this moment. Lastly, I just wanted to say I'm so excited to be here in this new role. I was at my very first annual meeting a year ago in Portland. I had just applied for this job very secretively and sat in the room and looked out at all of you and watched the level of discourse that was happening, the level of energy and excitement in the room, an organization that I had had a crush on already for a dozen years, blossomed into this full-blown love affair, and I thought, I'm so glad I just applied for this job. And regardless of what happens, I look forward to being in this space again with everybody next year in Austin. It's hard to imagine that I would actually be standing here at this podium, and I'm so grateful for this journey, for those of you who have put your faith in me and in this organization to weather this transition together, to enter this new chapter for the organization together. I cannot wait for all the wonder and joy and inspiration and ruckus that we are going to bring together this week. Thank you very much. So I want to bring up the folks who are going to be doing our group intros and icebreakers today. It's a little bit different than we've had it before, so I want to welcome Addam, Garrett, and Stephanie McKee.
Adam's making his way up here. How y'all doing this morning? So, there were complaints. Shake it up a little bit.
Welcome to the first annual NPNVAN Meat Market. You know, that's messed up. We'll ignore that. Before we begin, we have about 5 minutes. What we'd like you all to do is to get up, mingle around, and get at a table of a group of 5 to 6, or seven, we're going to say 5 to 7, of people that you do not know or do not know very well.
So let us tell you what the purpose of this is, okay? So the purpose of this is for you guys to get to know each other a little bit better. We're going to lead you through the process. As soon as the phone goes off, I'm just kidding, I thought I would pick on you. So we want to get to know each other a little bit better, and this is a process that is not going to stop here. It's going to continue through this annual meeting. There's something that we want you to know before you get started when you get to those tables, is that practice right now your active listening skills. So you know, a good conversation is always a conversation where somebody else can get in on it, right? It doesn't look like, let's try it. So, hi, how are you? My name is Stephanie McKee. I'm from Junebug Productions in New Orleans. And, you know, and what's your name?
We're actually doing this.
You're actually doing this.
Okay. With that, I am Addam. Addam Garrett.
Okay, so, you know, like I was saying, Addam, I love New Orleans. I don't know if you've ever been there. Have you been there before? Well, you know, it's how we don't want that to go.
Okay. Let's move.
Documenting all of this?
Yeah.
Got some great footage. Boom.
Thank you.
Devin Ackman. Nice with you. Oh, I'll turn into Roots. Yeah. What did you do? Yeah. No kidding. Yeah. You coming up around the holidays at all, or? Oh, congratulations! Yeah, you can buy it when you're up next time.
Yeah. And we're ahead of schedule.
Likewise.
We'll just, you know, be up
home. All right. I can introduce the artist. Just ask. Yeah, you know, I've been keeping my head down. So, yeah, I was coming into town and just doing the work. And where do you live?
Yeah.
I'm at 51st and Mayor.
Oh,
yeah. But I grew up in Elevator, right?
South Dakota. And we're going to do that for my people from Washington, yeah. D.C. who will really love and appreciate
what you went through our nation's spaces.
Can we get a little music, bro?
Oh, wonderful.
Next week, and also she'll be doing a new piece for us that's going to be a commentary on the situation in our country right now. So join me in welcoming Ebony Stewart. December 8th through the 11th, and there's flyers out there, and you can go to the website, you can find out all the information. They're not hard to find, but I wanted to like make sure that I give you a little bit of what hunger is about, the healing, the process of forgiving. And so I want to do this poem called Happy Father's Day. The child gets it wrong. He said, I only write about the bad things. Said I can't remember the good things. Said I couldn't know or remember all that bad. Said I was too young. Guess I got a good imagination. He say I'm still writing about old stuff. Guess I ain't got over it yet. He don't like how what I write make him look like he ain't shit. Like he ain't raised his kids. Like he don't love us still. Guess I shouldn't write the truth. Guess I shouldn't write how I feel, the way I grew up, the way I woman now. Guess I shouldn't make him look like he ain't nothing but some sperm donor, some dude. He say he tired of not being the hero in my poems. I say, me too. I write what I know. He don't like the memories he left me with me neither. Don't like being reminded of his faults, but I look in the mirror every day, got his face, what that make me? I say, how I'm supposed to escape. He say, you bitter. I say, that's what happens when you leave and ain't got nothing when you come back. I say, where I'm from, that shit hurts. He say, you ain't gonna be successful. I say, you made sure of that. And even if I am, you ain't gonna have shit to do with that either. He said, I bought you ice cream once. Took you to the movies a few times. Made you dinner. Played you and taken that time. Remember? Remember, I came to your volleyball game once. And that one time you played powder puff. Remember, I met your boyfriend once, twice, maybe three times. Remember, I bought that one book for that one class when you was in college that one time. Remember, I came to your graduation. Remember, I was at your wedding. Remember, we danced. Remember, remember, remember. I said, you show up to be seen. To get praise and glory that don't belong to you. Damn, I must be ungrateful, needing more than one book, help paying off these student loans. All you done shit, yes, I shouldn't need for shit. Not that shoulder when I got that divorce, when I almost got raped, when I broke my ankle playing those sports, cause I was only hungry once. Can watch the same movie for the rest of my life, eat only one flavor of ice cream, but I heard Baskin and Robbins got 32. Yes, I ain't no talking to on how to get hurt by all these boys. Who the best lesson? Guess your hurt was enough for the both of us. You right. I act like you ain't do nothing. Guess I ain't Christian. Guess I can't get over it. I'm so mean. Talk to you so bad. Treat you so funny. Guess when I grew up without you, I took you from me. Guess without you, I have nothing to write about. So thank you for teaching me how to make nothing out of something the way you raised me. Next poem, but I want to be respectful of your time. What I will say is there is a such thing as social media thugs, you understand? The click-clack clan, okay? And they hide behind that. But this is my way of clapping back. To the white woman whose YouTube comment said she is tired of every other American poem being about race or rape, I'm not sure if compassion fatigue happens because no one taught you how not to be the oppressor, or because no one taught you how not the oppressed but. Your comment reminds us that no one cares about us but us. You're right. There are no new topics. Just old problems written into new pleas to a country that refuses to reckon with its own sickness. We Americans, land of the free, can only keep our motto if we keep our mouths closed. And isn't that what all rapists want? Control and a silenced victim? Do you realize that someone has stopped listening to this poem because I am first black and also a woman? Black if I'm alive still, woman if I haven't disappeared yet, got anything anybody in the world might need except my voice, which means my body must be what's left for the taking. I'm not sure how we became treasures we can't afford to keep, but there are all kinds of women who have been raped, who hope their warm body's heart would stop beating, but still got up and went to work the next day. What we know is, it's hard to comfort a girl that doesn't let on she's hurting. So praise every woman that speaks out against her rapist. Praise the ones that didn't but got their healing from the poems you are tired of hearing. How easy your life must be to only sit through the happy while we try and believe the only things we need to remember about suffering is that eventually it ends. Three times now. On social media, I have personally watched a black person be murdered because the United States is still making us pay for the way we look or the guilt it feels, but a person of color's only glory, hallelujah, is as long as we didn't die, then we didn't die. Do you realize that when our mothers say, I love you, she is also saying, stay alive, come back to me whole, in one piece, and not a hashtag or another dead nigga's death she'll have to watch on repeat, us poets, whose duty is to write about the times, right? Because we don't know when we too will become extinct. Black ink from black poets who dare to write about all this black death instead of hiding behind everything we're thinking, how privileged your life must be. That you could be tired of hearing poems about race or rape while we the poets write about an extinguished race and violated bodies that keep being raped. It's not hard to believe you're tired. But can you imagine how exhausted we the poets must be? My name is Ebony Stewart. Thank you so much.
Two weeks before. because you feel a topic is so timely and so urgent. And so thank you, Caitlin, for your passion and your dedication. Hopefully, we'll be able to lock this down for you guys and get this off to a good start. So as I said, I'm Lauren, I'm the Vice President of External Relations for Archer Atlas. Been there 5 months, art's 5 months, still figuring this thing out. And I'm excited to be here. My purpose in being here has been pretty organic, and having this conversation with you guys about the urgency of this moment, because this is an urgent time. The blog post I wrote really was about how artists have always been at the forefront of radical change, and how, like, because of that, because I do believe that we have a serious threat, both to free speech, we've seen with Hamilton, we have a president who really does not have any respect for his office. I think that we have to prepare, and we have to be thinking about it now, so that we're not being reactionary. Because having worked in politics for most of my life, I know that policies are only what we choose to accept. And so we have to not accept things at every possible point. And so that's my open. My first opinion. This is actually a workshop. So y'all gonna be working and moving. I can't sit still for too long, so y'all gonna move it too. So don't get comfortable. We're on the Cowden Woods of Commitments, because I think we have to commit to things today and then find folks who are accountable for them throughout the next 4 years as you are in your own work every day. And so one of the things I'm interested in personally is really about capital. How do we help communities of color? How do we help artists build wealth? The same way that folks who have wealth continue to make their wealth work for them. So their $5 turns into $7, then $12. How do we leverage technology to build capital and build wealth and stability in communities? So that's what we're gonna talk about stuff like that. We're gonna really toss some things up in there and see what comes down. But hopefully we have fun and everything works out okay. So with that.
Hi, I'm Sixto Logan. I am the director for the Center for Art and Social Engagement. And I'm here because I was out there with you for so many years. As at DiverseWorks, as an NPN partner, and almost every program that NPN ever did, I was part of. And I'm here because this is home. This is where I needed to be because I know that if anything's gonna happen, it needs to start here. You all need to be the people to work with me and inspire me in order to change this emotion into action and make sure that these next 4 years are things that we can be proud of and know that we've done shit. So part of my job at the university is to reframe questions so that more people can be part of that conversation, that the dialogue is expanded, and that more people are empowered in order to feel that they can do something. And that's what I'm hoping we all are going to be here doing today. I think the other things are, we need to also recognize that where we are as individuals might not be the same place as where our institutions are. At a university, I recognize I can only do so much, but as an individual, I know I can do a lot more, or a lot different. I need to understand what the power is, and I need to all, hopefully, work with you all in order to understand when those things can come together and when things need to be separate. And that I assume from all of you all that sometimes the organization won't be able to move as fast as you want it to do. But that's fine at this point. What are we doing in order to be able to move that organization? And what are we doing as individuals in order to make sure that when we come back together again next year, that we can look each other in the eye and actually be held accountable for the shit that we said today? So that's the other part, is that I want everybody to be able to find a partner and a collaborator in order so that a new for your organization. And I want you to be able to find somebody to hold yourself individually accountable for what you are planning and committing to do today.
So I'm going to try it from the side, but I'm going to put this pad down. It's hard to follow, right? So, my name is Madison Cario, and I am and have been many things, as I'm sure you all are and have been. Currently, I am the director of the Office of the Arts at Georgia Institute of Technology in Atlanta. And I'm really honored to be the leader of a new program there that allows me to support and encourage creative collisions at the intersection of science, engineering, art, and design. And so I want to take a moment to tell you that I'm incredibly grateful to Caitlin, wherever she went, I see her, and to NPN for the invitation to be here. But I have to tell you a story, because I have to tell you that I'm only standing here on the stage because I got lucky. I got really lucky. So in lieu of a regular intro, I'm going to tell you a little story, because that's what I like to do. Growing up poor, the daughter of a recent immigrant and a woman with severe mental illness, I was told numerous times to settle down, to pick one thing, a gender, a job, a place to live. I was told to stop daydreaming and to grow up. I was told to keep my mouth shut and my legs crossed. I was told to not get dirty, to suck it up and just accept my position in life. I was told that I wasn't college material by my own guidance counselor in 11th grade. I sent him my diplomas, each and every one of them. And no, I was told that art was not for us. It was for someone else. Thankfully, I didn't believe most of what I was told. But for some reason, I did believe that art was not something for me. For a long time, until October 1994. So on October 7th, 1994, I got dragged to the theater to see some local dance. At this point, I had finished a bachelor's in rhetoric and communication, and a stint in the Marine Corps as an electrical engineer, and I had a good job, good life. I did copyright law for a major medical publishing company, so I was happy, right? So there I was, sitting in M3 in the Mandel Theater in Philadelphia. I think there's some Philly folk in here, we'll know. Yes. So you can tell by the fact that I remember what seat I was in that this was an emotionally charged moment. So there I was, sitting there, dreading, looking at my watch, pretending that I had a watch over. See, we've all been there. Dreading this evening of local dance shorts. And then some magic happened. Right? We've all had this moment. So this woman gets on stage, and she danced a solo with a narrative that was just too familiar for me to ignore. With movement and text that left me speechless. My heart pounded, kind of like it's pounding right now. And my eyes filled with tears. And while I can't tell you exactly what happened that night in that theater between that woman and I, because that piece was for me, right? You know those pieces that are just for you? That one was for me. I can tell you that I left the theater on fire, and I wanted something new in my life. So within a month, I did the reasonable thing, and I quit my day job. Thanks for your support. It's just I started writing for dance companies. And I applied for my first grant to make a performance. I'm thrilled to tell you that not only did I get that grant and make that performance, applause. I got that choreographer to help me. Not only did she help me make that work, she has stayed by my side for 23 years as my art and life partner. And voila, here I am today. Okay, so I skipped a couple decades from 94 to now. And I'm telling you this story because I think you get the point, right? Because there's some magic out there that happens if you let it happen. And before we get our head and our heart and our shoulders into the obstacles ahead of us, I ask that each of you close your eyes for a moment. Go ahead. It's okay. Caitlin assures me this is a safe space. So close your eyes. I'll be nice. And I want you to go back to that time or times that your life was transformed by art, an artist, a a creative connection. Feel that energy, right? Kind of flows up through your core and makes your palms sweat and your heart beat. In that moment, that transformational power, that energy, I call it love. Stay there. You're gonna need that love. So as you come back to this world, you don't have to open your eyes, it's not pretty. This 2016, where the potential for violence, fear, hatred, misogyny, homophobia, and discrimination seem to be all but unstoppable, I ask you to remember that each and every one of you is here only because you got lucky, right? I know we work hard, we work damn hard, but we are so effing lucky. I didn't say it, but you know what I mean. So, yes, okay, we gotta open our eyes now because we have work to do. So we're gonna pull on our shit-kicking boots, and we're gonna pull ourselves up, and we're gonna remember that as we start to do this work, to bring that joy and that laughter and that magic with us. My desire for us in this session is that we all take stock of what we have, we recognize what we might be missing, and that we build pathways, tunnels, bridges, networks, whatever it takes to keep us all connected, inspired, in love, lucky, and strong. We are the dream catchers and the storytellers, and now more than ever, we need to honor that and make sure that every, and I mean every dream is caught and every story is told. Can we do it? Thank you for that. All right. So now we're gonna start the work. Where am I supposed to stay now? Because I got lost in story world. Oh, we're gonna find out who's in the room. Okay, we've all done this exercise before, so we're gonna give you directives and you're gonna need to stand up if you feel that this applies to you. Now, you can stand up as many times as you want or you can not stand up, it's up to you. I'm going to start us off by saying, anybody who identifies as an independent artist, please stand. And when you stand, make sure you look around the room so we can see the community and the love around us.
Service organization or anybody who can actually help and support an independent artist. So those of you who have actually also supported any crowdfunding campaign, online campaign, or given to your friend or yourself as an individual artist, why are you not standing up in order to support yourselves? You all have, please, you've been in this room, I'm sure that you've given yourself, or your artist friend, at least some money or something, right? We're all here in order to support each other. So, the next thing, I'm glad you're all standing because now we're gonna move again. It is out about the call to action. We need to know where we are and where we wanna be. So, in what this is gonna happen is at the four corners, that if you agree with this next statement, I want the strongly agree over there, kind of agree, kind of disagree, and strongly disagree over here. Now, this is also a spectrum, and clearly, like, I know that a lot of you all don't really care about my instructions, but hopefully you all will really follow this. And part of this is also when, and please, there should be no judgments about this. We need to be holding this accountable and know where we are and what's happening. And this is also about, the question is, I am actively working toward disruption and change. So if you strongly agree, kind of disagree, or strongly disagree, and recognize that even if you are doing things as an organization or individual, there is nothing about the judgment in this, know where you are and where you are right now about disruption and change. I'm so glad that we're actively just disrupting and changing so slowly. If you are so active, let's get a little bit more active because we got another question going.
Can't all go to the same place. Right?
Okay. Look, y'all are ready.
It's gotta be a couple
now,
people left.
I'm also gonna say that there are people and there are organizations who might not have been ready for this because they're keeping on, keeping on. You've been here, you've done this, you continue to do this. And that's great and that's fine. And thank you so much for the work. Now, you all are here, so I'm gonna assume that this is where you are right now. Where do you want to be at the end of this convening? Are you ready for active disrupting and change? Strongly disagree? Kind of agree. Strongly disagree and over there, because I need y'all to separate. Are you ready and active and ready to do some work? Are you kind of not sure where you're gonna go and what's gonna happen? Are you sure that you don't know where that's happening? Or are y'all just ready to stand and ready to do some work? Because if that is, I need to hear you.
Oh, sorry.
I am so glad that you are there, because now look around to the people next to you, and you have now started to find the people who you are going to be holding accountable at the end of this meeting, and ask them what is their commitment in order to do that change. I know some of y'all over there are radicals. That's great. Make sure that we all can be able to move that out. So, come back to your seats, please.
Yeah, so the question,
Slowly, slowly.
Oh, okay, right. Before that, you were... Gotcha. But we didn't meet. But now we've met. Yes.
Anniversary.
As a matter of fact, in the Bay Area this weekend, there are a whole number of events. There's a huge reunion happening. The American Studies Association is meeting in Oakland, and there is an event marking the 40th anniversary of the Black Panther Party, which was founded right there in Oakland, California. And if some of you know the history of the Black Panther Party, you know that it came about because a few people decided they wanted to do something about rampant police violence in the city of Oakland. Huey Newton, Bobby Seale, and, you know, many people are reluctant to talk about Huey Newton's contribution because of his trajectory and his putative involvement with drugs and the way he died. But I'll never forget what Erica Huggins said at Huey's funeral many years ago. She said, you know, everybody has their demons. And Huey had his demons and he could not deal with them. But that does not change the fact that he helped to spark a whole new phase in the movement against racism in this country. And so when he and Bobby Seale decided that they were going to patrol the streets of Oakland, California, and they were going to take guns, that time it was legal to take guns. I mean, you could carry guns as long as you didn't conceal them. So they weren't breaking the law. And they were going to take a law book, and they were going to monitor the Oakland police, so that when the police stop somebody, and I know racial profiling is still a major, major issue, especially right here in this area. But when they saw the police stopping people, they would simply go and stand by and say, we want to inform you of your rights. And so they would have a law book in one hand, right? And then they would have their gun in the other hand. And, you know, I mean, I don't want to romanticize guns. I really don't. I don't want to romanticize violence or representations of violence. But what I can say is that that was an amazing feat of the imagination. That was an amazing feat of the imagination. Because it demonstrated that the kinds of strategies we had accepted as transformative, the civil rights strategies, work only up to a certain point. And we didn't have to stop there. We could go further. I mean, this was their way, and I have to stop talking about this in a minute because I'm running out of time. But this was also a way of manifesting solidarity with people who were struggling in Asia, in Vietnam, for example, with people who were struggling for their liberation in Africa, with the people of South Africa, for example. I mean, this is how I interpret the symbolic meaning of the weapons. But then I would also have to talk about the, you know, masculinist, militarist, you know. I mean, and all of that's there, too. There were real problems with the way the Black Panther Party unfolded, but that's okay. Because that was that period. And besides, we did not have the vocabulary, we didn't have the concepts which allowed us to think about the masculinism that was so much at the heart of that work, and many of the liberation movements as well.
There's a slide with a word cloud on there.
everyone saw when that video was shot, but it was shot in 2006. And so she was actually talking about George Bush. She was anxious about him. I miss George Bush at this point. but I wanted to pull out for the purposes of our discussion today a couple of things that she said. She talked about, very briefly, radical individualism. Because I think that we've got to a point in this country where we do think, sorry, she said heroic individualism. Everybody's got to be a hero. I think that is part of why we feel so fractured right now. And perhaps we need to step back and group together a little bit more and come up with solutions together instead of thinking about ourselves as so individual. Everybody's unique, but let's find some commonality. I love the phrase that she uses. She says, amazing feat of the imagination. And I think when we begin to talk in small groups, it really is about taking your stuff, yourself out of your day-to-day life to think about how can you shape things up and disrupt things personally or in your own organization to really affect change? Who's most vulnerable in your communities? Are you currently acting, working with them to help them become less vulnerable? And really identifying what the threats are in your community. And I know we've got folks in rural areas, we've got folks in urban areas all over the country, everyone's context is different. She also talks about recognizing when a strategy stops working and pushing past that strategy, developing new strategies to move forward and really create change and affect change in, you know, in whatever you're doing. And I think it's really important for us to stay connected, both you know, in our communities and across the country, and I guess at some point around the world, because we're seeing actually shift towards right-wing stuff all over the world. And so it is the role of the artist to stand in the face of that. Create new strategies and really innovate the way we work together to do that work. But I think that video was still so timely. And I was shocked when I found it online that that was 2006. So we fucking gotta do something different. It is imperative we do something different, feel some urgency around it. And with that, I'll let my much more eloquent partners over here just do this yourself. Oh no, we're doing a turn of talk, right? Okay, so if you guys want to discuss the table, amongst yourselves, sort of any reactions you have to the video. Had about 4 or 5 minutes for that. And just your own personal thoughts about what really triggered for you in watching the video. Did you feel it was relevant? Did you feel it was total bullshit? You know, really just getting your thoughts on the video.
I think now there was an error. There was a
I know, right? 5 minutes is not going to fall.
You can hear my voice loud twice. 1, 2, 3, all eyes on me. Does anyone want to share out the conversation they had about the video? Anyone really eager, just jumping in your chairs? Can't wait. Pushy. Okay. Take 3 more minutes.
Okay, so I'm gonna try and bring y'all back now. Hopefully it won't be quite so. I like this resistance. It'd be great if y'all went out to your communities and resisted, like y'all just resisted me. I like the, no, we're not moving. Stand in my place. Do I have to do a teacher thing again? Please help me. 1, 2, 3, all eyes on me.
Hi.
Okay, I heard some good conversations, and I understand why I want to keep talking, but I swear we have so much time for you to talk. Does anyone want to share out about the conversation very briefly now? No. Okay. Back there? Good hustle. See, that's how you're supposed to move across the room.
Alice Valdez from Mecca on Center in Houston. We live in a young practical member. four-year-old building, and so we have tenants. And when I saw who is most vulnerable, in our community at Mecca, we have a group called a United We Dream. And to me, right now, they're the most vulnerable, is the dreamer kids, young people, who Trump keeps saying that they're going to deport. But what I found out a couple of days ago from my daughter, who's an immigration lawyer and works with this group, that they have had nine dreamers commit suicide or attempt to commit suicide. One of them coming from our group there in Houston, out of desperation, out of fear, who knows, not enough support possibly. But to me, I think they have the most vulnerable situation with Trump and Pence.
Awesome, thank you. Really appreciate that. And that's a great segue into, that was up there because I thought you were going to let me move on, and you didn't. So the next turn talk opportunity is to discuss that very question. You got it at start, so we can like take a break, go have a drink. Where we go? It went away again. The questions are, for you and your communities, having discussed the video, who is at stake? Who is most vulnerable, and what is at stake in your communities? I heard a lot of conversation about politics, generally. What can we do? That's the next part. What I want you to do is identify the people who are most vulnerable in your communities and figure out what is at stake for them right now. So, take some time.
start to come back? I heard a couple folks talking about voting and about how only 40% of folks who could vote voted. 1, 2, 3, all eyes on me. You can hear my voice, clap once. You can hear my voice, clap twice. Thanks. I heard a number of tables just really briefly to interject, talk about voting. Please remember there are countries that have mandatory voting. So let's be really clear. Our country does not want everyone to vote. So perhaps once we get to the action point, we can start thinking about that. But let's be clear, it is a very concerted effort to make sure that everyone's voice is not heard. And that has gone on historically. So just wanted to point that out for those of you who were talking about that piece of being apathetic. If we want people to vote, we tell them they had to vote, be required. Gotta pay your taxes, gotta vote. So just something to think about. I have two great scribes. My handwriting sucks. I would love it if you could shout out answers to who you identified as the most vulnerable people in your community.
The poor.
Standing Rock.
I hear Standing Rock. I hear undocumented.
Youth.
Women.
All of us.
Working class people. Uneducated. The homeless.
Muslims.
Muslims. Sorry, what was that about? Okay, I think we have queer up there.
Children.
Native people.
Immigrants.
Journalists. Excellent. I heard a table talk about activists. That was a great answer, I thought. Activists. Okay, we've got the aging, the elderly.
Incarcerated.
Folks who are incarcerated.
African American
people with disabilities. Trans women of color, yes. Okay, I think y'all got a lot of Jewish folks. Absolutely. Someone else had their hand.
And then there was a discussion about who is the most, and does it become oppression Olympics, and so that I get everybody.
Yeah.
And that we're all dynamic. There are moments where we can be the shield, and there are moments where every single one of us might become the person who is the subject.
Absolutely. Freedom of expression, First Amendment rights.
Healthcare for all.
Life.
Imagination.
Abortion.
Someone said democracy.
Democracy. Humanity. I'm sorry, what was that?
Humanity.
Respect. Future generations.
Freedom to move.
Freedom to move.
The Supreme Court.
Supreme Court, SCOTUS.
Our hope. The possibility of internment camps.
Ooh, look at deep.
Tribal sovereignty.
I'm sorry?
Tribal sovereignty.
Autonomy?
USA.
Anyone else?
Freedom of movement.
Women's bodies.
Freedom of speech.
Freedom of speech.
Complexity as a value.
Complexity as a value.
Okay.
Critical thinking. I think that's good. Critical thinking's been gone for a while. That one easily went out like 99. Democratic institutions. Faith and leadership and a sense of community.
Voting rights.
Voting rights.
Generosity and trust.
Generosity and trust.
Food access.
Food access.
Reputation of Twitter.
Safe spaces.
Nuclear weapons.
Nuclear weapons. Truth. All right, this is a hell of a list. So thank you. I'm gonna pass the mic for our next, you'll have more time to talk. And really to think through who's most vulnerable, what's at stake. And this is the part where you get to figure out what you're gonna do about it. And call it some commitments. So, pass the mic.
Thank you. Can I add love to that list, that's what's at stake? Okay, so now I get to do some more work. This is the fun stuff, really. It's really trying to turn it over, sleeves in. Take some of these ideas and kind of drill down a little bit. So for the next 5 minutes, we're gonna do something a little bit odd. I'm gonna ask you to work independently. We don't do this very often, but just for the next 5 minutes, work independently, and I want you to kind of peruse the list of things that are already up here, but also think about your own practice and your own work and figure out what's your top like barrier or obstacle? What's the thing that's getting in the way of you doing what you feel you need and want to do? And also think a little bit about a strategy that you might use to overcome that. But really spend the next 5 minutes reflecting on your own practice, whether it's your professional practice or your artistic practice. On the table, there are pads, and if you could please jot down some notes, because we are gonna do a share out, and you won't be sharing your own. Now, there's a couple rules before you start. There's always rules, right? No idea is too ridiculous. Okay, so let's just have that as a really big and important rule. No action item is too small either, so don't judge yourself. And really take a moment to define radical change from your point of view. Right? Your perspective is what we value here in this room. All right, you ready? Any marks? Get set. 5 minutes. Go. The prompt, is that what you said? The prompt is that I want you to think about your practice and identify a barrier or an obstacle. And it can reflect some of the things that we've already talked about in terms of vulnerability and what's at stake, but find a barrier or an obstacle, something that's in your way from doing the radical change that you want to see happen and that you want to be a part of. Is that helpful? And an action item or a strategy to deal with that problem. Thank you. This is your 1 minute warning. Okay, if you can start wrapping up that sentence, I would greatly appreciate that. And what we're going to do now, when you're comfortable with however that sentence is ending, is to take that piece of paper and pass it to the person on your right. And this is the awkward part of the bad handwriting of father. So once you've completed that pass off, what I want you to do is to have that person share out what you wrote. So everybody is going to share their barriers and the strategies to deal with their barriers at the table. And since you're talking, I know that you probably already started this, so good. You have 5 minutes to share out, and then we're going to interrupt you again.
Phone calls to communicate what? Just to like reach out.
Yeah.
interesting to hear like representatives like if that has.
Thank you.
So what are we?
Yes.
Most vulnerable. So while this is not Olympics, we are in triage. So our share out's going to reflect that. So while we're not going to go down the entire list of most vulnerable, we have selected folks who, for a variety of reasons, probably are most vulnerable. And y'all just have to live with that. We can talk about it later. Yes.
Problematic that we're having a vulnerable competition. It's not a competition. It's not a competition. It is not a competition.
I would say that it's an acknowledgement.
I think it's a trap in a way. Because if we start to we even had it here, we had a moment where Lara said, well, we all know who's most vulnerable. I forget who you said. You said the dreamers.
The dreamers.
And then I said, well, I don't know that. And we had a conversation about that. Well, you know, it's not them. It's this person. No, it's not that group. It's this other group. I think it's not the question of who's suffering most. I think it's just not the right question.
That was not the question. In the context of this conversation about the political climate and what we can do, part of our problem is that we can't identify problems. And so if you can't identify a problem, you can't have a solution. Those solutions should be interwoven. So you can have folks who are struggling at the same time. That doesn't make anyone struggle more or less. It's really important to acknowledge it. And so until we can say the words, until we can acknowledge that folks are struggling, I don't think it's a competition, I think it's acknowledgement. So that's my pushback. We have very limited time to share out. We can holler afterwards. I'll be around all weekend. We can go back and forth. I went to law school. I love it. So we can talk forever.
But I also think that part of what we all need to do individually and organizationally is go back to what is our purpose and where are we focusing? Because we have been focusing about a lot of different things simultaneously, and we have effectiveness might have been dispersed. So part of the question that we are trying to pose to you all is what is the thing that you can focus on and prioritize for now and decide that this is where your action needs to be for now. We recognize that things are going to change and things are going to shift, but if we are not focused, we are not going to be having any type of commitment or any type of movement in the next 4 years. And so, as artists, you all know what, like, we hope that we understand what your purpose is. As organizations, we hope we understand what your purpose is. Where are you individually, and where is your organization going to focus today? So we're going to ask, and we're going to start with, for those of you, like, if you have decided that African Americans are the most vulnerable community, has anybody have an idea or a task or an action item that they would like, or I'm sorry, not vulnerable, that they're going to focus on and to prioritize? Anybody want to report out on that?
So for me, I work at the Kelly Sharon Theater in the city of Pittsburgh, and I also have a nonprofit called True Teen Entertainment, and we do programming for LGBT people of color. And I will say that in the city of Pittsburgh, funding for LGBT people of color is very limited, and it's all kind of absorbed by the Delta Foundation, which is like the overarching LGBT organization, and they only support the white communities for the most part. So my action step would be, give us money. But I'm trying to figure out how to do that, because we've actually gone to the mainstream media. We got A.D. Azalea not to perform at Pride. But I mean, we've made, we've made a big deal about this for years and years, but it's like, it's not changing, and I don't know what the action step would be. So we're gonna.
Have you identified resources?
Yes, Kelly Strayhorn Theater, and all of you, hopefully, but I guess, to go off of what Gennaro was saying, I guess the hair and the vulnerable, what we think is most the most vulnerable communities, it kind of throws me off because I feel like we're all in the arts community and we're all watching the news and we see what's happening right now, and it just kind of, I don't know, it's disheartening, kind of.
I just
want to
say that Democrats are good people. Liberals are good people. I'm assuming everyone here is a liberal. Anyone here not a liberal? Sorry, I don't want to call you.
Don't assume.
I'm not assuming, right? I am assuming. You're right, I am. Folks who are not good people have focused very clearly on denying people their voting rights through a variety of tactics. They focused on one thing, and that's where they are. That's why they've achieved what they've achieved. We have to pick one thing. Everybody here has to pick one thing. And I think your point of dilution of effort is spot.
The violence that's out there is a reflection, a crystal facet prism of the violence in our own selves. We have collectively talked about the absolute urgency of everyone doing deep internal work about your own, our own, my own complicity in allowing oppression, not speaking out for it. I'm not going to, yes, who's it? Every goddamn body. What can we do about it? If we don't start here, nothing will happen.
Quickly, I just think it's important that we find out what's the most vulnerable in our own communities.
I have a friend of mine who does Palestinian-Jewish conflict, and she went to Palestine to go do some research, and one of the hip-hop artists in Palestine goes, fix what's happening with you guys. You can't fix what's happening everywhere if you don't fix what's happening with us, which echoes to what you're saying. It's all reflective of what's happening with us. For me, in my list, I said, I gotta start with my own family. How I treat my children. And then from there it circles out, it's a Buddhist way, right? And then the ring goes out further and further because you have hope and you know that that person over there is gonna do something in his community and she's gonna do something in her community and everyone's gonna do what's most vulnerable in their community. And at the end of the day, it's everybody who's vulnerable, right? But it's all of us who are gonna fix it together, not fractured, right? So I understand what that is, and I don't think you're trying to divide anybody. And I think it's important for us to like clarify that right now. It's what's most vulnerable within your own, where you can make effective changes, and that's within your own community. Grassroots, remember guys, that's the way the tree starts, right? And the grassroots up.
So I just want to say that in this conversation about vulnerability, there are specific groups of people who have been explicitly named, Mexicans and Latinos and Muslims and anybody who looks Muslim or could be perceived as Muslim, LGBT communities, Black Lives Matter. There are groups that have been explicitly named by the incoming administration, right? And so one thing that we can do in our own communities is begin to, if we're not already doing it, partner with those groups. And I am not sure that we are all in this network committed to presenting and touring and showing and doing residencies with and doing deep community engagement with artists who are from the groups of people who are being named and targeted. Right? And there are lots more people who are gonna be targeted. I'm not confused about that. But I'm saying that can be a starting point. A starting point can be that we, before we leave here in the next few days, every single presenting organization in this room commit to presenting artists who are part of the communities who are being most targeted explicitly right now.
When we were speaking here, we were talking about the people who are most vulnerable are the people who are also not engaged with these groups who have been targeted by the groups that she was speaking about, like Blacks and Latinos. And if there was some way that we could get these people who to empathize with the people who are feeling oppressed, and how can we do that? Aaron had a great idea about going to the places where these groups dominate, like Trump supporters, but people who feel opposite the way that you think, and going into those communities and coming out of our safe spaces and just kind of starting your own grassroots in these communities to try and get people to empathize and listen and educate as well.
I just want to do a time check. We have to be out in 3 minutes, so the share out didn't happen the way I thought it was, but I still thought it was beautiful. I think y'all amped up. I think you're ready to have some really difficult and really beautiful conversations. So we'll take one more.
Okay, and want all the white folks in the room to stand up. Please stand up, or move your chair, scooter, whatnot. Okay, so invitation to action step. I want you to stay standing if you, I as a white person, will commit to every single day talking to other white people about white supremacy and racism in your family, at the breakfast table, when you visit your folks, at holidays, in your organization, board of directors. Sit down if you're not ready to make that choice. And just think about that if you're sitting down. Thank you very much. Really quick, the other thing is anybody, so sit down, white people, sit down. And sit down, white people. Someone told you I was about to say that, this white person. But please stand up really quickly if you are a funder or a presenter in the room. And if you do not have transgender organizations on your funding docket, I want you to think about that. And if you're a presenter and you don't have transgender music or theater or dance artists in this next coming season, please think about that. Thank you very much.
This is the start. We are at the beginning of our annual meeting. You have multiple days with an incredible network of incredibly heart and mind focused people. All the things that we talked about, all the things that you talked about, are deep, that almost all of them have been going on for centuries. The work that we are committing to is, what do we do next? And how do you find around the table and around this room the people who are going to help you, and the people who are going to hold you accountable. In the next 3 to 4 days, make sure you have found other people in order to help you on that path. Also, over the course of the next year, you have a network of people, of presenters, of everything around here, because that's what National Performance Network is about. Utilize this network and the resources that they provide in order to move the needle.
Okay. I just want to say thank you. Thank you for the work that you did here today. Thank you for opening your hearts and minds to each other. And I encourage you to keep doing that this whole week and the rest of the year. Thank you, Caitlin and Ebony, for having us.
I'm a Virgo, so we gotta get out here on time. Thank you.
I believe we need to find Harold Stewart. From the South Dallas Cultural Center, board member, and Shannon God.
Thanks, Will. I'll try not to fall on my face.
I don't know. I think we have some. Thank you. How y'all feeling?
Good.
Some people are feeling good. How's everybody else feeling? We'll save the music for the outro in the interest of time. My name is Harold Stewart, a proud Dallas, Texas individual.
Texas in the house?
Texas is definitely in the house.
And I'm Shannon Dowd. I'm the cultural affairs manager for the city of Santa Monica.
I'm the manager of the South Dallas Cultural Center. The manager of the South Dallas Cultural Center. All right, so we're here. First of all, as a part of the Texas delegate, I'm a part of that delegation. I feel it is necessary to give you a big old Texas welcome, but not by myself. There are other people here who are Texas delegates, and if you don't know that you are one, you qualify because you live in this great state, you were born in this great state. You had to come here for a job. You got an ex that lived in Texas. So any of those things, you're a part of the Texas delegation. And if y'all can join me in, with a big old Texas, hey y'all, to make it about it. Now you know, you're welcome. Texas.
All right, so we are here to get some money from you all to support NPN Ban. In the last year, NPN Ban has supported over 1,000 artists, provided $1.8 million in subsidies to diverse artists, supporting 175 residency weeks, and boasts the cutest staff and board of any arts organization.
And if you can see it, you know, an example, here we are. So we're gonna ask you, our family, our partners, and